This is the world's fastest A1278 MacBook Pro with 3 internal storage. Stay watching as we're gonna guide you step by step on how to make yours now. Welcome back to iBoardFastest channel. This is the complete soldering guide for installing NVMe SSD on the A1278 MacBook Pro 13-inch 2012. If you correctly follow this installation guide, the first PCIe port here is capable of driving a single NVMe SSD at a full-speed PCIe 3.0, or you can optionally move this PCIe cable to the second port here, and now you have an access to the external PCIe X4 slot that can be connected to an external GPU for higher graphic performance. This guide is intended for enthusiasts with intermediate level of soldering skills and tools. So the first step is you need to disassemble a good working MacBook Pro and take its logic board out of its chassis without damaging the related components. To proceed on the soldering phase, you should have the main logic board out of its chassis, and the goal for this phase is to modify the main logic board from this to this. The additional components that you can see here come together with the A1278 NVMe upgrade kit. So for those who have received this upgrade kit, you should check the contents inside the package, and it should have a NevBolt-1 adapter rebolt with 0.5mm solder balls, one distribution board for A1278 that has an M.2 NVMe port, one IPEX high-speed cable, one IPEX 40 pins connector, and finally, one 3.3V power wires. So what you're gonna need to do now is you need to remove the left speaker from the main logic board by gently pulling the speaker and microphone wires from the socket, revealing the Thunderbolt 1 chip beneath the speaker. Remove the DC inject and both of the RAM sticks to avoid heat exposure to these components. For the heatsink, we're gonna leave it as it is for now to protect the CPU. Next, you need to remove the silicone epoxy around the Thunderbolt 1 chip using the hot air gun. Usually, we will use the highest temperature and air settings on the quick hot air with the nozzle on, and the actual heat reaching the main logic board is controlled by adjusting distance from the board. By blowing the hot air to the epoxy by maintaining 2-inch distance from the target, the surrounding epoxy should become soft, so you can carefully remove them using a pair of tweezers. Make sure to keep it slow and gentle to avoid knocking off other capacitors or resistors nearby. That will be the last one. So after the epoxy has been removed, create line markings around the Thunderbolt 1 chip as close to the chip as possible, also using the same tweezers. This black color coating on the whole surface of main logic board that you can see here is what we call black solder mask. So by applying slight pressure on the main logic board, scratch the solder mask on the right side, upper side, left side, and finally lower side of the Thunderbolt 1 chip. It is important to note that you should not scratch the board too hard, or else the copper traces beneath the solder mask will deform and break. These lines will assist you for the NevBolt 1 positioning later on. Now you are ready to remove the Thunderbolt 1 chip, so we will take off this nozzle from the hot air gun to allow better heat distribution across the board to make the desoldering process easier. Before we are pointing the heat directly on the target, we need to preheat the local area first, as shown in the highlighted area. Move the hot air gun in a circular motion targeting the local area, maintaining around 1-inch distance from the board, as we're giving time for the board layers to absorb heat and distribute the heat across the board evenly. This preheating method will prevent thermal shock or thermal stress to the Thunderbolt chip, and also to prevent delamination of the board layers beneath that is useful in this project. The concept is almost like removing the SMC chip, so actually this is not the only way to do it, but at least it works really great for us. As you preheat the local area for around 1 minute, the board should already retain enough heat, so bring the hot air tip closer to the board, targeting the Thunderbolt chip. One of the ways to know if it is safe to take off the chip is to poke the AC coupling capacitors at the side of the Thunderbolt chip. These capacitors will need to be removed later, so it's perfectly fine if we mess with it now. If you can move the caps, it means the lead-free solder on that area already reaches liquidous temperature, so you can slowly try to leave the Thunderbolt chip using the tweezers. Now we have successfully removed the Thunderbolt chip and you should see the line markings that we created just now. These are the lead-free solder balls that you have to remove before placing the NevBolt-1 adapter in place. To start wicking the lead-free solder off, we personally recommend you to use the flat-tip soldering iron and run the surface with leaded solder first. Apply flux to the solder balls and begin to feed the leaded solder wire to the flat-tip iron. After covering all the pads with leaded solder, we will begin to use solder wick to remove the solder completely. Use the Q-tip with 99% isopropyl alcohol to clean the mess a little bit. Next, we will remove all the AC coupling capacitors at the side of the Thunderbolt 1 chip. Since this is a PCI X4 lane, it has 8 differential pairs or 16 transmission lines, or we can say 16 copper traces to transmit and receive data, resulting in 16 AC coupling capacitors. So this is the list of 16 capacitors that you need to remove, and you need to take note of each capacitor's orientation, whether it's in horizontal or vertical position. These transmission lines are directly connected to the CPU. Now put the nozzle back to the hot air gun and blow the hot air directly to the AC capacitors and begin to remove all of them. Now, this is the most tedious part of the whole process, where you need to replace all the removed capacitors with 0.1mm jumper wires. You literally have to solder jumper wires to each of the 16 capacitor pads, one by one. So we will start with the first differential pairs on the left here, and it is in horizontal position. Apply flux to the pads and start to make solder bridge using 0.1mm jumper wires that should lay flat on the surface. This time we're using a micro soldering tip to make soldering process on the 0201 solder pads much easier. Cut off the excess wire using a sharp blade and make sure it is precisely cut to not have any protruding wire that looks like this bad example as highlighted in this picture. While your NVMe SSD might actually work without giving too much precision on these solder bridges, these protruding wires might increase the EMI and reduce the signal integrity of the high-speed signals for the PCIe lanes. As a result, your read and write speed will not reach the highest value as it should. You should also be careful when using the sharp blade to not accidentally cut the copper traces like the ones in this picture, as this mistake will cause no NVMe detection at all. After completing the second solder bridge on the first differential pair, you can proceed to the next differential pair that's in the vertical position. Repeat the same steps until you finish the last 8 differential pairs. After you finish soldering all of them, you might want to reflow them a little bit with flux to let the surface tension do its job. Now, if you try to take the NevBolt-1 adapter from the NVMe upgrade kit and try to align the NevBolt-1 adapter in place, you will find that it collides with several capacitors and resistors. These components are only Thunderbolt-1 support components, so you can just safely remove them now as we will not use Thunderbolt-1 anymore. Now we are ready to solder the NevBolt-1 adapter to the board, so we will apply flux to the Thunderbolt footprint and spread it out to all of the solder pads. Next, locate your line markings that we have scratched earlier and use them as your placing guide. We will represent these line markings as a red square, so now you need to place the NevBolt-1 and try to adjust and align the square part of the NevBolt-1 precisely into the red square. Take off your hot air nozzle again and perform the same preheating steps to the local area of the main logic board. After 40 seconds or so, you can target the heat directly to the center of the NevBolt-1, but this time it won't take too much heat to reach liquidus because the NevBolt-1 balls are actually leaded solder balls. Let it cool for a few minutes, and after the heat is gone, you can slowly try to nudge it to determine whether it's properly soldered or not. The next step is you need to find the RST pad on the NevBolt-1 adapter. Now you need to connect the platform reset L signal to this pad using 0.1mm jumper wires. The closest location that you can put the signal is from the R4283. Solder the wire to pin number 2, and you have to avoid routing the wire near the PCIe copper traces. connect the other end of the wire to the RST pad and cut the excess wire. Next, look at the other side of the main logic board and find the U3810. You need to remove this load switch and create a solder bridge connecting both PP3V3SO and PP3V3T29. The reason why we have to do this is because the load switch is only able to deliver a maximum current of 2 amps at 3.3 volt, while the aftermarket NVMe SSD like the Samsung 970 EVO requires 3.3 amps at 3.3 volt to operate properly. So we need to remove the underfill covering the load switch and blow the hot air gun directly to remove the load switch. Use the 0.1mm jumper wires to create a solder bridge between PP3V3SO and PP3V3T29. Now we will measure our connection's integrity on the IPEX footprint according to this diagram. We will be measuring diode mode on each of the pads to make sure that all connections are properly soldered and attached to the board. To start measuring in diode mode, take your multimeter and switch to diode mode, put the red probe to any ground on the board, and the black probe is used to read the test points. Put the black probe on the first pin at the top, which is the ground pin, so all ground values should read 0.000. The next one is a differential pair that consists of two copper traces. A single copper trace in a differential pair should have a value close to its partner, in this case 0.330 and 0.329. The next differential pair should also have a pair value close to each other, and this time it measures 0.321 and 0.322. Repeat the same step to the rest of differential pairs and make sure that none of them are shorted to ground or OL. The last two signals here are the clock request and platform reset signals. These two signals can be of any value except 0 or OL. Then you need to check the 3.3 volt pad. It should have the same diode value like the PP3V3SO. You need to make sure that all the diode values are correct, but if you get unfortunate and have a different value on one or more pins compared to what we have stated here, it means something is wrong with your alignment or solder joints, or maybe your solder bridge and the AC capacitors are not connected really well. So you have to solve this issue first, only then you can proceed to the next step. Now you can take the IPEX female connector supplied from the upgrade kit, and you can solder it to the NevBolt-1 just like you solder the LVDS port for the LCD. Before placing the IPEX connector in place, you need to apply flux to the pads and align the connector to the footprint. Put the tweezers on the notches at the top side of the IPEX connector to help you hold it in place. By using flat tip soldering iron, you can see that we place a solder blob at the tip of the soldering iron and begin tapping on the first and the center pins of the connector to help it stay in place. So now you can release the tweezers and proceed to solder the rest of the pins, and you can add more flux where necessary. Lastly, you need to solder both of the left and right side of the housing for better grounding and stronger support. Use the Q-tip with 99% isopropyl alcohol to clean the mess a little bit. If you want to clean the main logic board with the ultrasonic cleaner, you can do it now. Next, take the 3.3 volt power wires from the upgrade kit, and before soldering it to the NevBolt 1, you can wind them up to make it look neat. You need to solder both of the black and red wire to the same 3.3 volt pad, even though we know that usually black is for ground and the red is for power. Before we finalize the soldering process, it's a good idea to clean the area a little bit with Q-tip and isopropyl alcohol, and you can use the UV solder mask to cover the exposed platform reset L wire. This is also the right time to reapply the thermal paste to the CPU if necessary. We have finally reached the end of the soldering phase. So all that's left is to reassemble the whole MacBook, and from this mark, there will be no soldering skills required. The final goal for this reassembling phase is to replace the optical drive with the specially designed distribution board and install the main logic board into the chassis again. You can click on the next video to begin with the reassembling phase. That's all for now. Don't forget to click the subscribe button and see you again at iBoardFastC channel, reverse engineering at its best. Thanks for watching.